Good morning, everyone. We're going to start with a verse. Well, first off, just take a look of your announcements and make sure you take that home with you, because there's a lot going on this week, so you're up on everything that's happening. And I'm going to start with a verse from Isaiah 26. You will keep in perfect peace him whose mind is steadfast, because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord is the rock eternal. And just knowing we've got that rock to stand on and to hold us whenever needed. So let's greet one another in Christ's love and in the Palm Sunday celebration here today. And then we'll join to sing together.
Gracious Lord, we know that we live by your providence, and now we pray that we may learn to be more than conquerors through Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave himself for us. To that end, help us to walk with deepening awareness with him as he faces the cross and as we face our cross. Amen.
Holy, 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 holy.
come up for children's moment.
Good morning. How are you?
You want to hold one of these? Can you hold one with Daddy?
So we're talking about parades today. And I just gave Carver a flag. And we're all familiar with the big parades that we celebrate. For us, the 4th of July parade and as we hand out water, and people line the streets with noisemakers and bright lights and flashing things, and we're usually waiting for someone to come in a big fancy car and screaming all the hellos and handshakings, and there's just all kinds of celebrating going on. And then I want us to take a step back and think about another parade. And it was a parade that there was one man on a donkey that came into town celebrating Passover, and people had become very fond of Jesus, and they came to celebrate his coming into town. And instead of waving flags, they had palms. And they had palms, and they waved the palms before him. And some of the things that they were shouting was that, you know, today they celebrate King Jesus coming into Jerusalem. And they shouted, "Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David." And maybe next service the kids will help me out a little bit. And shouted things like, "Blessed is he, the one that comes in the name of the Lord," and "Hosanna in the highest to the heaven." And they waved the palms, and many of them laid their coats or their cloaks down in the road for this man who came in on a donkey. And it was the beginning of the triumphal entry of Jesus into the town, and the beginning of a huge, huge week that went from Hosanna to the highest to crucify him. And as we go through this week, may we remember just every single day that passed, and that Jesus was fully aware of what was happening to him, and he had committed his life to do the work of his Father. And he had committed to giving his life for the sins of ours. So may we say a prayer. Dear Jesus, our voices join with the voices of the people in Jerusalem some 2,000 years ago. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. So Carver, I'm going to trade your flag out. And these palms right here, turn into this. And you can have this and put this up on maybe the mantle at Grandma's house or in the kitchen. Yeah, okay. All right. Thank you. You can take...
Thank you, Jen. Good morning. Let us pray for illumination. Wipe the scales from our eyes, Lord, and break the hardened crust that encase our hearts, for we are here to study your word on this glorious day. Redirect our focus, realign our wills, so that you are the center of that what we say and do. And please, make the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts pleasing in your sight. In Jesus' name we ask, amen. Today's first reading is Philippians 2, is found on page 951, and is 5 through 11, and is imitating Christ's humility. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Our second lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew. It's Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. It's found on page 801 in your pew Bibles. It's titled, Jesus Comes to Jerusalem as King. Matthew 21. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and at once you'll find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to daughter Zion, see your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them and for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna, son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, who is this? The crowds answered, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. The whole city asked, who is this? And the crowds, the folks massing on the streets, answered, well, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. And I imagine them responding with, yeah, we know, but who is this? And that's really the question, isn't it? Has been for centuries, in fact. It's the ultimate question, really. Who is this one called Jesus? I know he's a rabbi and a teacher, and yet he's supposedly a king. I know he's coming right now in a most majestic way, and yet he's doing it humbly in an unexpected way, on the back of a colt. So who is this that's coming into our lives? Because he is, you know. The whole city was stirred. And I imagine that's an understatement, don't you think? I mean, this is a political tsunami unfolding before their eyes, a religious whirlwind, really, not to mention a roller coaster of emotion. Not a single person in all of Jerusalem is unaffected by Jesus' arrival. nor in the surrounding countryside for that matter, or throughout history, in fact. So the question's real, isn't it? Critical, even paramount. Who is this? Everyone wants to know. Scribes and the Pharisee want to know because they're the religious establishment. This Jesus fellow could easily undermine their entire time-honored belief system. The chief priests and elders, the teachers of the law, want to know because they're trying to discern by what authority Jesus is doing these amazing things. And the government wants to know, right? The Roman overlords, as well as that local puppet King Herod, because if this is some kind of insurrection, an uprising or rebellion or a military coup, then they need to squash it immediately. Who is this guy? And what does his arrival mean? Everyone wants to know. The average person on the street wants to know, because if Jesus really is the long-awaited king, the one descended from David, then this is not a moment to miss. The folks who have seen the miracles certainly want to know, because if Jesus is the Messiah, if he is who he says he is, then there are eternal ramifications here. I imagine even those who stood outside of Lazarus's tomb want to know, don't you? Because Jesus clearly is the one who raises people from the dead, like Pastor David shared with us last week. Even the disciples want to know, or at least they want to make sure. I mean, they had to be in a swirl of emotions themselves, right? Put yourself in their sandals. They've been hanging around with this Jesus fellow for over 3 years, and they've seen some extraordinary things. Some of them are actually eyewitnesses to the transfiguration, remember? Others drank the water that had been turned into wine at the wedding in Canaan. Still others saw him walk on water and saw him calm the storms with just a word. All of them would have helped to pack up the leftovers after he fed thousands of people with just a couple of fish and a few loaves of bread. They've all heard him teach and preach. They've all witnessed his life up close and personal. They should already know, right? But do they? I can't help but wonder. After all, one of them's about to betray him. And another, in just 5 days, will publicly deny even knowing him. 3 times, in fact. Not a solitary one of them will stand beside Jesus as he endures torture and the most grueling death known to man. So maybe they don't know. On the other hand, all of them, with the exception of Judas, of course, will willingly die as martyrs after the resurrection. Think about that. All they would have had to do to save themselves was simply deny their faith in Jesus as Lord. So did they know? Now they're approaching Jerusalem, and they find themselves in the midst of a very large crowd gathered on the Mount of Olives. They're about to process down through the Kidron Valley and up into the city in a great big parade. They'll pass through the beautiful gates shortly, shouting and waving palm fronds, praising God with all of their hearts. Apparently, they've answered the question, right? At least on the surface, at least temporarily. This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. However, most of them, I think, are still wondering, yeah, but what does that mean? Have you been there? More to the point, maybe, are you there right now? What I'm asking is that our question too? How we answer it does have profound ramifications, eternal ramifications, really, because if we respond one way, we'll most likely watch this Middle Eastern parade today and simply smile, and then go right on with our daily lives. It was a fun event. People all looked good. Celebration was simply amazing. But what's that have to do with me? Or if we answer it another way, we'll most likely start to follow Jesus at a safe distance, of course. Cautious, probably, but curious. We'll be willing to follow, at least at first, maybe even a little anxious to see more. Show me something, Jesus. Impress me. Maybe then I'll hang around for a while. Keep me entertained, if you will, or fed or prosperous, and I'll stay. But then if we answer it in still another way, we might just find ourselves dropping to our knees as Christ steps before us in this majestic parade. We might stoop down and grab a palm frond of our own, you know, step into the middle of the pageant ourselves, maybe even boldly declaring our loyalty. So it's a good question, isn't it? Great question, really. One that causes a definite fork in your theological road. Who is this Jesus? This one that some call Messiah. What's all this fuss really about? It's Passover in Jerusalem, tourist season, if you will, and the city's packed. The population is normally somewhere between 60 and 80,000 people, depending on which historian you read. Three or four times the population of Benzie County. But during religious festivals like this one, it would swell to well over a quarter of a million people. The hotels are all booked. The inns are full from morning to night. The law of God given through Moses dictates that all believers celebrate the Exodus each and every year. The faithful must look to their salvation by God's own hand. They need to sacrifice an innocent lamb and share in a Seder meal. And the only appropriate place to offer a sacrifice to Almighty God is at the great temple in the city of Jerusalem on Mount Zion itself. So the faithful are making their annual pilgrimage from faraway lands when this Galilean prophet comes riding into town on a donkey, followed ironically by a whole entourage of screaming folks. Try to picture it. Jesus has entered the stage like a Pulitzer Prize winning author or a rock star or your favorite contestant on American Idol. People are screaming, save us, Hosanna, Hosanna, and they're flailing their arms. There's an atmosphere of excitement. There's not been a real king in Israel for almost 600 years since the time of Solomon, David's son. They're waving palm fronds like a sea of flags. The emotions are at a fever pitch. There's a smile on every single face. The people are rolling out the red carpet, covering the streets with coats and palm branches, excited that a celebrity has come into town. It's Oscar night and the 4th of July and Country Music Awards all rolled into one. Enthusiastic followers from both sides of the street are cheering with all their might. The only thing missing is the paparazzi recording the event, which, come to think of it, may be Matthew's role. Jesus is a star running back who's just scored the winning touchdown in the Super Bowl. The crowds want to hoist him on their shoulders. You're the man, our hero. We're right here with you. Imagine what that was like. Now ask yourself, if that was you, how could you not let something like that go to your head? The Apostle Paul, the author of much of the New Testament, says that our attitude, the way that we encounter the world, should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant, becoming obedient even unto death on a cross. Wait, what? Corrie Ten Boom, a hero during the Nazi occupation of Denmark, a famous Christian writer and speaker, was once asked if it was difficult for her to stay humble with all the notoriety and such, and her reply was simple and yet profound. She said, when Jesus rode into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday on the back of that donkey, and everyone was waving palm branches and throwing garments on the road and singing praises, do you think for 1 minute it ever entered the head of that donkey that any of that was for him? If I can just be the donkey on which Jesus Christ rides in his glory, I can give him all the praise and honor. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. Which begs that question once again, doesn't it? Who is this Jesus? This Prince of Peace and Lord of Lords. Who is Jesus to the world? Who is Jesus to you? Today's Palm Sunday. And believers across the globe are celebrating in packed churches. People are waving palm fronds and symbolically shouting Hosanna. And next Sunday on Easter morning, the faithful will celebrate with joy. We'll gather again to give thanks to God because we know who this Jesus is. He's the one who burst forth from the grave, conquering death and sin, creating a way for each one of us to stand in the presence of a holy God. We're currently standing on the summit of two mountain vistas, Palm Sunday and Easter morning. And it's easy to see Christ the King from here. We effortlessly hoist Jesus, our Lord and Savior, up onto a pedestal and visualizing him processing down the streets in all the pomp and circumstances or sitting at the right hand of God in all of his glory. But there's more. Isn't there? Much more. You simply cannot jump from Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday without going through the events of Holy Week. You just can't. And if you try, you'll miss a lot. In fact, the entire point. You see, today is also known as Passion Sunday, which illuminates a whole other dimension to who this Jesus really is. Jesus made it quite clear prior to this parade that he's headed to Jerusalem to be put to death. He's mapped out the entire plan ahead of time. There are no surprises here. Today's procession into town marks the beginning of the end. In the next few days, Jesus will continue to share amazing teachings. He'll address abuses in the current religious system. He'll continue to heal those who are afflicted. He is a great healer, a wise religious reformer, a superb moral instructor, to be sure, but that's not all. Jesus will also sit down at a Passover meal with his friends and recall all the blessings that God has bestowed upon his people. Freedom from captivity, providence in the wilderness, and salvation in the promised land. He'll kneel before them and humbly wash their feet, including those of his close friend Judas, who will betray him, and Peter, who'll deny even knowing him. And by this, demonstrate unconditional love. Later that same night, he'll undergo an agonizing time of prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane. He'll be arrested violently in the middle of the night. He'll be put on trial several times and beaten beyond anything we can imagine. If you've never seen the movie The Passion of Christ, it might be a great time to do so. It is horrible and graphic and filled with love. Crown of thorns will be jammed down into his head, and the fickle crowds will start screaming again. Only this time it'll be, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Another parade will begin, one only in this one Jesus will carry his ever so heavy cross through the streets of the city with the jeering crowds. And finally, just before noon, without a complaint from his lips, Jesus will lie very still as they drive the spikes into his hands and feet, that wooden cross, and then drop it into the ground with a thud. That's who Jesus is, in case you didn't know. That's the answer to the question. Jesus is the Word of God who became flesh and dwelt among us. He's the creative Word there at the beginning, and the redeeming word who came and spoke on our behalf. He's the incarnate word of God who willingly and obediently went to the cross in our place, paying for all our sins and taking the punishment that we deserve. And he did all that so that we might have a righteous relationship with God, so that we might walk in his holy presence for all of eternity. At just the right time, it says in Romans 5:6, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. That's who Jesus is. You know, there are all kinds of witnesses to who Jesus is in Scripture, many of which have different perspectives. There's a condemned criminal hanging next to him who mocks him with words of contempt, and the other one who accepts him as Lord and is thus saved. There's the political leaders as well as the religious ones of every stripe who resist and twist everything he says in order to hang on to power. There are the disciples who will deny him and betray him and yet who will walk on water themselves and heal people in his name after they repent. There's the crowds, the fickle, selfish crowds who on Sunday exalt his presence and then by Friday forget him completely, who scream for his death or in their apathy treat him as if it's already so. And there are the faithful few who even in the darkest hour kneel at the foot of the cross weeping and then look up in comprehension. But you know, one of the most powerful witnesses to who Jesus really is, at least for me, has always been the Roman centurion who also stood at the foot of that cross. He's a master sergeant, a legionnaire, a man who commands 100 tough fighting men, a man who administers beatings and punishments in order to keep his men in line, a man who holds grave responsibility, including carrying out executions for those who are condemned to death like Jesus. This is a fierce, hardened Roman soldier who watches with fascination as all these things happen to this man of God. He's never seen a man take such cruelty without responding in bitterness, with no cry for pity. He's never seen such a humble man so obedient to his cause. And after holding his emotions inside and all this truth for as long as he can, this centurion finally cries out from the very depths of his soul, "Truly, truly, this is the Son of God." And that, my friends, brings us right back to the beginning. We're standing here on Passion Sunday, about to step into the events of Holy Week. So you tell me, who's Jesus to you? Because that's the only question that really matters. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. I invite you to listen for the Holy Spirit nudging your hearts as we stand and sing. Will you please stand?
Go of every single dream, I let each one go. You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. You are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Your ways are always higher. Your plans are always good. There's not a place where I'll go you've not already stood. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give me answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. I will trust.
Each week we come together as a family of God. We share with one another both our joys and our concerns and lift them up before the Lord in prayer. There are a number of people on your prayer list on the back of your bulletin, and I invite you to take these folks with you and pray for them by name. We have a number of additions. Lloyd Putney is still at Munson. He's out of the step-down unit and on a regular floor, so that's good news. But they're waiting for an internal leak to heal itself, or they may have to go back in. So please keep Loy lifted up. Sherry Lundquist is dealing with grief. As you know, her mom and dad have both passed away in the last few months. So keep Sherry in your prayers. Talk to Don Smeltzer. He's dealing with some health issues. I'd like to keep Don lifted up in our prayers. And as you know, Sarah Esper went home to be with the Lord. Her memorial service will be at St. Francis on April 15th at 10:30 in the morning. Visitation an hour before that, and also on Friday night between 6 and 8. And Kim DeBruin, Ed and Joyce Howard's daughter, She's been in the hospital for about a month. She's headed back to Florida. Shirley, is that correct? And I think mom's going with her to help take care of her. But they live in Florida. Okay. Thank you. So keep really Kim and the whole family in your prayers. Are there others that we would like to share this morning? Quiet Sunday. It's Palm Sunday. It's not supposed to be a quiet Sunday. I did like seeing Mary Barnum with her. Seeing no others, could we be in a spirit of silent prayer with one another, please? We humbly bow before you this morning, Lord, not because you see us that way, but because we see ourselves in the light of the truth and know that we fall short of your glory. We come humbly, not because you've chosen to elevate yourself above us or away from us, but rather because you've chosen to come to us in love and live with us and be with us in community, in a personal relationship, even though we clearly do not deserve that honor. It is a privilege, Lord, that you allow us to come into your presence and be so humble, and this honor that causes us to give you praise. Father, we're grateful for the gift of life and for the many gifts that you give us within this life. We're grateful for wisdom and the ability to learn. We're grateful for health and the ability to make ourselves healthier. We're grateful for our hearts and the ability to reflect, for the realization that we are sinners, and the ability to come to you for forgiveness. We're grateful for the many blessings that you bestow upon our lives, and for the ability to bless others in your name. And mostly, Lord, we are grateful for the gift of your Holy Spirit, grateful for being called together in your name, and grateful to be able to come before you with our pleas and petitions. Lord, you've heard our silent prayers just now, and you know of our heartfelt joys as well as the burdens that are dragging us down. You know what makes us smile, and you know what troubles our hearts. So now, Lord, hear us as a family, your family, as we collectively set some additional cares down. We lift up before you Lloyd Putney and Sherry Lundquist. We lift up Don Smeltzer and the family and friends of Sarah Esper. We lift up Kim DeBruin and her family and all those who are on our prayer list and all those, Lord, who are silently on our hearts right now. We place these loved ones into your presence, asking that you will touch their lives. We lay down their burdens and their troubles at the foot of the cross, asking that you will replace them with your overwhelming peace. We offer up all of our cares as well and all of our concerns, all of our praises, and all of our celebrations to you, Lord, for you are the author of life. And we do this in Jesus' name. And with the very prayer that he's taught to us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus rode into town on the back of a donkey. Did you know that the donkey is the favorite animal at a petting zoo? Look it up. Everybody loves donkeys. So I thought I'd go through scripture and find some really cool donkey passages to share with you just to kind of uplift you on this celebratory day. Genesis 22, Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, took two of his young men and Isaac with him. An innocent ram appeared in the thicket, and he was killed in Isaac's place. Numbers 22, Balaam rose in the morning, saddled his donkey, and went with the princes of Moab, and later the tribe of Israel slew Balaam with a sword. 1 Samuel 25, Abigail mounted her donkey and rode to King David, where she betrayed her husband, Nabal. She returned to Nabal, and when he heard the news, he died. 2 Samuel 17, when Ahithophel, David's counselor, saw that his advice was not followed, he saddled his donkey and went home. He set his house in order, hanged himself, and died. 1 Kings 2, Shimei rose and saddled his donkey and went to seek his slaves. Solomon was angry, and he sent Benaiah to find Shimei. Benaiah went out, found Shimei, struck him down, and he died. 1 Kings 13, a donkey was saddled for the old prophet from Judah. As he rode away, a lion met him on the road and killed him, and the lion and the donkey stood beside his body. And then, fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey. And they took him to the place of the skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha. There they crucified him. Two things came to my mind in this research. The first was, I'm never going to ride a donkey. But the second one is, Jesus knew. He knew. He knew what was happening. He was headed to Jerusalem in order to die for our sins. And at this table, we celebrate that gift.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that you prepare our hearts and just let us share this coming week with others so that we can show them how you have blessed us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. On the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you." Likewise, after supper, he took a cup, and after giving thanks for it, he gave this to his disciples, and he said, "Drink of this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sin. These things do in remembrance of me." Everyone who believes Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, is welcome at this table. Just come forward, break off a small piece of bread, or in David's case, a large piece of bread, dip it in the cup and partake, and gather around the sanctuary for our closing benediction. And if you're unable to come forward, just sort of alert us and we will bring it to you gladly. Come, for all things are now ready.